Welcome back. Mr. Patrick Arnold is now the outgoing president of PanTrinbago after four terms, almost 13 years there. He is on his way out now. When you're out, when Boogsie said,
and hand over,
yeah. And that should happen in short order.
Yeah, today.
When Boogsie collected his Chacuna medal goal, he said that Pan is dead. A sensational statement picked up by the public. What do you think about that statement?
I don't think he meant it. I mean, we took that maybe. He said Pan is dead, but Pan is not dead. Pan, I mean, Pan is flourishing in Trinidad and all over the world. So the instrument Pan is, you can't say it's the dead. If you want to say, and he spoke about the industry and businessmen and so on, and that is fine. You need that, which we have been talking about since 1998. And as I said before, people have to understand, PanTrinbago in those days, the price was $37,000. You get no, so you had a subvention of $45,000 per year. You have four offices to take care of, Northern region, South Tobago, Eastern region. You have staff, you have the rent to pay, and $45,000. So, well, how are you going to, what are you going to do? He could bring in chrome plants and create we took our limited resources and ordered drums from Chicago, mm-hmm. because the drum plant that we had in Lubbock went to Jamaica. So Trinidad, the land of the pan, the guys are right now using drums from behind those chemical plants with skull and crossbone on them and things that they shouldn't even go near to. Their heads are down in those drums tuning pans, which is a very unhealthy thing. And I've spoken about it since 1998. So I took it on myself to order drums from Chicago and Venezuela. You know, so we are still at that stage where we, NP took it over and they are now bringing in drums from Chicago and so on. But right here, if you have to go down the street and get a drum of a good quality to make pans, we have nothing like that here.
Mm-hmm. You were the person who took, the executive of PanTrinbago, took the decision to restrict arrangers to arranging for only one band in each category. Boogsie was upset about that too. Mm-hmm. He said that in a way that you're taking a bread from his mouth. What do you feel about that decision in retrospect?
In retrospect, I think it was a good decision because one thing you could see from that is that we have created a lot of young arrangers. In those days, you might go to the Savannah and just see three names on all the banners. And we have a 100 steel bands. So we had to do something to create new arrangers, young people who wanted to arrange. In fact, we created the junior arm of PanTrinbago. And they were allowed to do their own thing. They ran their own music festival, their panorama, and things like that. They themselves had ideas that we didn't have. And they did their shows in a different way. And so out of that too, we changed the rules there. Because in those days, when you come to junior panorama, all that happened is the day before, the same children that played with the big bands, they will turn up on Monday with the same tune, even the same banner. So that was changed too, so that even the youngsters could have done their own arranging. Because they played the same tune the band played Sunday. They played that on Monday. Just took the young people out of that band and had a junior band playing the same tune. And all that was changed because you had to play another tune. And you couldn't use the arranger. So all these things, at this point now, we could see the difference in that a lot of young people are involved in arranging and they do their own thing, even with the junior panorama and so on. So a lot of changes took place and because of those rules. And I hope that they continue to enforce them.
We have a National Symphony Steel Orchestra. We have a very vibrant panorama. We still do have a permanent home for Panorama. It's kind of back and forth.
We have no home.
No home for Panorama. No. So each year, it's, whether it's Skinner's Park or what's going to happen with it next year?
We went to Skinner Park because of the problem at the Savannah, but we are back there now. And we don't have any problem. I didn't have a problem if we went anywhere in Trinidad if the facilities are good. But we don't have that, and so we can't even use our biggest show at the Savannah. We can't even use that to generate enough funds so that we could do things we show is wasted because most of the people spend their time on the drag for free. They make tapes of the Panorama tunes. By Sunday, they're selling them down Frederick Street. So you can't even benefit from your own competition. You don't get the bars on the, out there. It's crazy. No other part of the world or no other show would be like that. You know, they're comfortable playing on the drag all day. And nobody would, why should you pay to go in the grandstand?
Is that first priority for the Pan? One, get a permanent location for us back in Savannah. Is that what the most important thing that needs to be done for Pan?
A proper venue, whether it's Savannah, you need a venue where the guys could generate funds, the movement could generate funds on their own, from bars, from things that marketing stuff, their t-shirts, their hats, their whatever, they can market these things. Big shows all over the world depend a lot on marketing, not just gate receipts. And we are not able to do that. The venue is not suit for that. And so the guys love the drag, but the drag, they're being ripped off because even the foreigners now are on the drag. They don't have to pay to go in the grandstand when they could stand up close to the Pan.
Now, you were calling for this venue. I mean, it's not a day that you're saying.
Yeah, yeah.
You felt
the
like
whole, you... I mean, the whole problem, as far as I'm concerned, is the authorities. If we had the venues, if we had the infrastructure, they wouldn't have any talk like Pan is dead and all kind of... That's crazy. Pan is not dead. Pan needs help. And the only people who could give us that help, as I said, just because... As you look at the sports, you have 5 stadiums.
You need the government.
Yeah.
Hi, good morning, caller.
Yes, good morning.
Morning to you, sir. You have a question or comment for Mr.
Hello?
Patrick Arnold? Yes, go ahead. Hi, caller, good morning.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes. I heard Mr. Arnold talking about the loss of revenue through people enjoying Pan and the Drag for free. There was a time when, as you crossed the road from Memorial Park,
right.
The drag used to have bleachers,
right,
followed by 2 massive stands that used to call the annex to the grandstand in North Stand. And that area was a paid venue.
Of course.
It was PanTrinbago who abolished that.
PanTrinbago, I was not wrong, but try as I may.
But I took on Pan.
On the board.
Continuity we're talking about in terms of officials. PanTrinbago always lamenting regards to who is the president about the loss of revenue. PanTrinbago gave up that massive stretch that we call the drag or the bull track. You should pay to go in there.
Yeah,
all right.
I know that.
Less than the grandstand, of course. But you should pay to go in there, and you all gave that up as a revenue owner.
Thank you, caller.
I don't know if they gave it up because I was not wrong, but I know I've been trying on NCC board every year to have that place fenced.
To find some means of earning revenue from the job.
Yeah, they refused to fence the place. I know what he's talking about. When I came back from holidays and so on, I used to, there were bleachers on both sides. Fence, you pay to get in there. So the bands, when they come down, it's an enclosed area where people pay to hear them rehearse. But that's gone, and no matter how you try to get it back, they don't listen. In fact, I did this, one of the last things I did on leaving PanTrinbago is to tell the board that we can't go through that. We need to get back the bleachers and the fences so that we can have a proper show.